Hello students, a very good morning to all. So in continuation with our first unit, that is atomic structure, this video is the last topic for our first unit. In this video we'll be discussing about Slater's rules. The Slater's rules are not directly in your syllabus, but many of the topics like probability distribution curves, Arkov principle and the electronic configuration of elements are based upon our many things are explained, many things related to these topics are explained on the basis of Slater's rules. You have heard many times taking me, mentioning me about Slater's rule in the discussion of these topics. So we'll be, in today's video, we'll be discussing about Slater's rule. So Slater's rules are meant for the calculation of effective nuclear charge. So first of all, you should know what effective nuclear charge is. Now, as we know that there is one nuclear charge, which is number of protons present in the nucleus that belongs to the atom. So if we talk about the outer electrons, if we talk about the electrons present in different shells for a single atom, the nuclear charge felt by all the electrons is not same. This is because there is some screening of nuclear charge by the inner electrons, which is exhibited by the inner electrons. And so based upon this, the outer electrons present in the outer shells experience less nuclear charge in comparison to the electrons present in the inner shells. So due to the presence of electrons in the inner orbitals of inner shells, the outer electrons experience lesser charge than the charge on the nucleus. So the actual nuclear charge felt by the electron is called as effective nuclear charge. This is represented by Z star, or we represent it as Z effective. We write it as Z, and in the subscript portion we write it as E double F, that means Z effective. So the electrons present in various inner orbitals serve as screen or shield between the nucleus and the outer electrons. The effect of such shielding or screening is called as screening or shielding effect. Z star, that is effective nuclear charge, can be calculated by determining the screening constant. Z star is equal to Z minus S, where Z star is effective nuclear charge, Z is the nuclear charge, which is equal to the number of protons, or we can say atomic number, and here S is the screening constant. Screening constant is a measure of screening contribution of all the electrons in the atom which are present in between the nucleus and the electron which are on which we want to calculate the effective nuclear charge. The calculation of screening constant is governed by set of rules given by the scientist Slater. So that is why these are called Slater's rule for the determination of effective nuclear charge, or we can say Slater's rule for the determination of screening constant, which further can be put into this formula to calculate effective nuclear charge. So let's get started with the rules of given by Slater's for the calculation of screening constant. Firstly, for the knowledge of Slater's rule, we must know if we'll be given the atomic number, and based upon the atomic number, we can calculate screening constant. Based upon these rules, we can calculate screening constant for any of the atom belonging to any of the element of the periodic table. So firstly, we'll write the electronic configuration, and what we'll do is we'll write the electronic configuration in this order. And here we can see that there are different groups. S and p orbitals belonging to the same shell number are grouped together, while d and f orbitals are presented in the separate groups. So in this way, we divide all these subshells into different groups, S and p in the same group belonging to the same shell. Here we can see 1s is placed in first group, then second group for 2s and 2p, then third group for 3s and 3p. And the set of rules we'll be discussing following this part will be applicable for this electrons present in one complete group. So 3s and 3p makes one complete group, 3d is one separate group, 4s and 4p make one complete group, and again 4d is the separate group. So in this way, these are arranged in the increasing order, increasing value of n and l. Here in the subgroup, l is increasing and n is same. Here we can see that l is increasing. So these are arranged in the increasing order of firstly n, then l. So this is a way how we can group the electronic configuration. We can group the electrons present in different orbitals for the. So this is the first basic step for the calculation of screening constant. Next, what we'll have to do is the electrons. Now let us see the rules. The electrons in any group higher in the sequence than electrons under consideration do not contribute to screening. So according to this point, if we want to calculate the screening constant for one electron present in this 3p orbital, so in that case, if there are electrons present in 3d orbital, then those electrons will not contribute towards the screening constant, as these are not present in between the nucleus and this electron for which screening constant is to be calculated. These are present outside this electron, so they won't contribute towards any screening exhibited by the electrons. Next rule is electrons present in the same group contributes the value of S is equal to 0.35. By same group we mean that here if the configuration is 3d10, then if we are calculating the screening constant on the electron 10th electron present in 3d orbital, then the other 9 electrons will contribute 0.35. or if we are talking about the electron present in this, then both the electrons present in both the subshells will be contributing towards S of 0.35. Next point is there are different rules for the group in which S or P orbitals are present and for 3d or for nd or nf orbitals. So for electrons in these groups where ns and np are grouped together, all electrons in n minus 1 shell will contribute S of 0.85 each, and electrons in the deeper subshells or deeper groups, that is where n is equal to n minus 2 or lower, will contribute the S value of 1. So from here, if we are talking about 4s4p, say we are talking about this group, then electrons, say it is fully filled, it is 4p6, and we are calculating for the 6th electron present in 4p subshell. So the electrons, there are 5 rest electrons in p orbital and 2 electrons are here. So 7 into 0.35 for n minus 1, there are 2 plus 6 plus 10, that means 18 into 0.85. So contribution from n minus 1 subshell is going to be 0.85, and the other lower shell, the contribution is going to be 1. So it is going to contribute as 2 plus 2, 4 plus 6, that means 10 into 1. So this is going to be the screening constant for electrons present in 4p orbital. So next is for an electron in nd or nf, all the electrons in the lower groups contributes S is equal to 1. So all the lower groups are going to contribute S is equal to 1, and in the same group the contribution is going to be 0.35. So we're talking about 3d electron. Here 9 other electrons are going to contribute S is equal to 0.35, and the lower group electrons are going to contribute contribution of 1. So that means how many, let us count the electrons, 2 plus 2 plus 6, that means 10 and 18. So 18 into 1 is going to be the screening constant plus 9 into 0.35. So this is the screening constant exhibited by electron, experienced by the electron present in 3d orbital. Let us see one example. Calculate the effective nuclear charge on electron present in 4d orbital and 5s orbital. So first case is 4d orbital of silver. So let us write the electronic configuration of silver first. This is the atomic number of silver. This is the electronic configuration which we have divided into further groups. So we have demarcated the group. We have kept s and p orbitals belonging to same n in single group and d and f in separate groups. So first question is, first part is we have to calculate the effective nuclear charge on an electron present in 4d orbital, 4d subshell. So here let us see, n minus 1 or as it is, as it belongs to nd or ns category, that means n minus 1 groups are going to contribute 1 per electron. So let us count how many electrons are there. 2 plus 2, 4, 4 plus 6, 10, 10 plus 2, 12, 12 plus 6, 18, 18 plus 10, 28 plus 2, 30 plus 6, 36 into 1. And in the same group, they are going to contribute 0.35 into 9 electrons are there, rest of the electrons. So 0.35 into 9. So total screening constant has come out to be 39.15. And Z effective is going to be 47 minus 39.15, that is 7.85. So this is how we calculate screening constant. For 5s electron, the rules are different. So there is one electron in 5s orbital. So for this, screening constant is going to be 0.85 into 18. For this shell, we are taking 0.85 contribution for n minus 1 category. And these all electrons belong to n minus 2 and lower category. That means contribution is going to be 1. So there are total of 28 electrons. That means 1 into 28. Total screening constant has come out to be 43.3. And Z effective comes out to be Z minus S, that is 3.70. So next point is, we have to calculate the Z effective, that is effective nuclear charge on the periphery of silver atom. So by periphery, we mean that electron is just present in the next vacant place. Here the next vacant place is 5s2. So we'll have to calculate effective nuclear charge for 5s2 contribution, or we can say for the anion of silver, for the one negative anion for silver. Although it is not possible, so it is just an assumption that for periphery we take it as anion, that the extra electron will take up the space of the next possible slot, and all the electrons present in the electronic configuration are going to contribute for the screening constant. So here contribution from this electron will also be there. So here it is 0.35 into 1, 0.85 into 1, 18, and 1 into 28. So Z effective is 3.35. Next we have to calculate screening constant for Ag positive. So for Ag positive, the electron is to be taken out first from 5s orbital. So the electronic configuration for Ag positive is going to be 4d10. So for the electron present in 4d10, that means is Z is same, number of protons are going to be same, that is atomic number is same, but one electron has decreased. So it will be same as that of 4d, 10th electron of 4d. So fourth part will be screening constant, or we can say Z effective for the fourth part is going to be same as that of first part. Also from here you can see, if we take it as this is cation, this is for Z effective for cation, and here we have calculated Z effective for anion. Here we can see that Ag positive and Ag negative, Z effective for Ag positive is more. That means for the case of Ag positive, the effective nuclear charge on the outermost electron is the almost double in comparison to that of the silver anion. So from here, this can be concluded that based upon this, we can say that is why size of the anions are always bigger in comparison to the size of the corresponding cations. So now let us discuss the applications of Slater's rule. So Slater's rule provides the qualitative justification for a sequence of orbitals in the increasing order as per the energy level diagram. So we have discussed the energy level diagram for multi-electron systems. There, the order of the orbitals as per the energy was discussed. So that can be explained. If we want to quantitative treatment for that, then that can be explained based upon Slater's rule. As more the Z effective, more is going to be the lesser is going to be the energy, and it will be placed prior to the more energy orbital. Next, we have Slater's rule. Based upon Slater's rule, we can explain why filling of ns orbital is done before n minus 1 d orbitals, and why for the formation of cations, why electrons are taken out first from ns orbitals in comparison to n minus 1 d. Let us take the example of zinc and potassium. So for potassium, here let us take the case of 19th electron present in potassium. So here we were having two options, that it can fill the 4s1 orbital or the 3d orbital based upon the energy of which is less according to for the multi-electron system. So for that, the energy of 4s orbital was found to be lesser, so that is filled first. So let us explain this based upon Z effective. Let us calculate Z effective for both these electrons based upon this electronic configuration. So Z effective for 4s1 configuration has come out to be 2.2, and Z effective for 3d1 configuration has come out to be 1.0. So here we can see that Z effective for 4s1 is greater. That means it has more nuclear pool. More the nuclear pool, lesser is the size. Lesser is the size means lesser is the energy. So based upon this, based upon Slater's rule, we can say that as Z effective of 4s1 is less, that means it is going to be filled first in comparison to this. Same is the case for the formation of zinc 2 positive ions. As we all know that electrons are first taken out from the 4s orbital. So we have studied it by discussing the electronic configurations, that electronic configuration for the ions. But based upon Slater's rule, we can explain this. Here we have calculated Z effective on both the electrons, that is the electrons present in 3D and also the electrons present in 4s. So here for 3D, the Z effective for the outermost electron has come out to be 8.85. And for 4s subshell, the Z effective comes out to be 4.35. Here, for the case of 4s, Z effective is lesser in comparison to that of 3d electrons. So these are experiencing more nuclear pull in comparison to the 4s electron. So that means these are more tightly bound by the nucleus in comparison to the 4s electron. So it is easy, or we can say it can be It is comparatively easier to take out electrons from the 4s orbital with the expense of small amount of energy in comparison to that of 3d orbital, electrons from the 3d orbital. So that is why electrons are, while formation of cations, electrons are taken out first from the ns orbital in comparison to the n-1 d orbital. Next is Slater's rules also explains the trend of different periodic properties like atomic size, ionization energy, electron affinity, and electron activity. And many other properties are explained based upon this Slater's rule. So here we have taken the example of second period. We have calculated Z effective on the outermost electron for the second period. Here we can see that Z effective is continuously increasing as we move from lithium to neon. So this means if Z effective is increasing, that means nuclear pull on the outermost electron is increasing. So based upon this, we can see that ionization energies are increasing as we move from left to right. Electronegativity is going to increase as we move from left to right, as Z effective is increasing. And also, size is decreasing because nuclear pull on the outermost electron is increasing. Based upon that, the outermost electron for neon are tightly bound. Size is decreasing from lithium to fluorine, but neon, as it is a noble gas, so it is also, it doesn't take part in the bonding, so it doesn't have its covalent radii. While talking about the size of noble gases, we always take the size as van der Waals radius. So size for noble gases is exceptional. Rest of the things can be explained here, that size is decreasing up to when we move from lithium to fluorine. Next point is Slater's rule helps to explain the anomalous configuration of many of the elements. So based upon Slater's rule, many anomalous electronic configuration which we have discussed so far can be explained based upon the Slater's rule. Also, it provides justification for why the size of cation is always smaller and anion is always bigger. This we have already discussed based upon the example of silver. So next we have limitations of Slater's rule. In Slater's rule, all the s and p orbitals for same n, so for the same value of n, s and p orbitals are grouped in one group. That is, they are grouped together. But according to radial probability distribution curves, which we have studied, orbitals have more penetration and should screen more in comparison to p orbitals. S orbitals are more penetrated towards the nucleus in comparison to p orbitals. So they should exhibit more screening in comparison to p orbitals. But based upon Slater's rule, they have been grouped together. So it can give misleading results sometimes. Next we have electrons in SPDF. So electrons in SP, D and F orbitals of lower energy levels, that is for n-2 category, for the shell number of n-2, screening constant has been taken out to be same. That is, contribution to screening constant is one for all, but it cannot be energetically true because they have different penetrations based upon their shapes. So based upon this also, results can be misleading. So although Slater's rule have been applied to a large number of elements and they have explained many things based upon that, many trends of the periodic table they have explained based upon Slater's rule, we were able to explain the anomalous electronic configuration, but still Slater's rule when applied to heavier elements become less reliable in comparison to the lighter elements. So we can say that Slater's rule are very much valid for lighter elements, but for heavier elements there is slight deviation as from the Slater's rule for heavier elements. So that is it for this video. This is all about Slater's rule. I hope you have found it interesting, and these are very important based upon for your competitive exam point of view, for your explanation of many topics which we have discussed in solid atomic structure. So you must know how to calculate Z effective, and you must know how to calculate screening constant. This is a very important topic from the competition point of view. So that is it for this video. Thank you so much.